Okay, I indicated that we are going to have four speakers. The first one is Bill Holliday, who's talking about I-91's impact on Brattleboro. And also had a lot of collateral impact on all of us. So, Bill, I will...
Put me on the clock.
I will come up here and loom that. I'll try to get you a high sign in when you have 5 left, okay?
Well, I may not have that because I prepared a 10-minute talk. Somehow he didn't get the message, but when they very cordially gave me a call to come and do this, very, very nice, she said 10 minutes. 10 minutes, so you didn't get the message. Not my forte. But I'll try to do better. The other thing that happened was when they very graciously called to let me know about the talk tonight. She was saying to me on the telephone, the Windham County Historical Society, we're going to put you first. She was being so gracious. You know, this is very, very important. And I could hear a voice in the back saying, don't tell them, we always save the best for last. So I'm up here as the sacrificial lamb. Also, 1936 election, I'll bet there are a few people here who can remember that. Alfred Mocton Landon of Kansas, the Republican, running against Franklin Delano Roosevelt from New York State. Roosevelt, looking for validation for what he had done his first term with the New Deal, and this election was going to answer it. There were only 48 states at that time in the United States, and 46 of them voted for Roosevelt, the Democrat. The two that voted for Alfred Mocton Landon were Maine and Vermont. That's the end of the talk. 91, Interstate 91 is the reason we're all Democrats today. One thing I did want to say, though, there are a couple of young people here tonight, and history isn't worth preserving if it doesn't have somebody to pass along to. So thank you, young people, for being here, and whoever brought you. Okay, you probably have been able to tell here that I brought some pictures of the impact of Interstate 91 on Brattleboro, particularly Putney Road, which is now essentially the center of mercantile life in Brattleboro, not downtown anymore, although Brattleboro's downtown is modestly vibrant, but with lots of novelty shops. All the supermarkets are gone from downtown Brattleboro. It used to be a buzzing place on Thursdays and Friday nights because people like yourselves from here in the valley would go into Brattleboro, go to the grocery store, stock up for the week, and maybe go out and dine. It was really a happy place. Now it's closed up at 6:30 any night, except gallery lock. But you can see the interstate here going through, and the first bridge across interstate, across the West River, excuse me, has not been built yet. This is the West River, south, southeast to northwest. And of course, it sort of looks like this again, right now, doesn't it? This entire lane has been removed. It's going to be part of the new bridge and, over here. But one of the things that this did, and the next slide I want to show you, slow enough. You sure? Can you hear me? There's a microphone here, but all right. So I chopped up this photograph a little bit, and here's Putney Road working its way in 1958, 59, 60 through Brattleboro, and you can see that the entire west side from the West River out here to where the intersection is today, the roundabout is farmland. And that farmland belonged predominantly to two families, the Thomas family, different branches of the Thomas family. I'll show you where one of their farmhouses was on the location of the auto mall dealership today. They were very gracious to me a little while ago. I went over there, and I don't have a helicopter, So I asked them if I could go up on their roof, and they hemmed and hawed a little bit, finally put me on a forklift. Up I went, and I said, you know, it's not too much weight, is it? And they said, no, no, you're okay. I climbed out onto the roof. I said, you probably should have me sign something before we did that in case I fell off. So I have some photographs of this area. But I happened to work with Emerson Thomas. You might remember that when the Thomas farm was cut, I'm not going to call it in half, but this majority of the bottomland farmland that the Thomases had eventually was lost, and this is all parking lot and businesses today. But Emerson Thomas retired at a relatively early age and went to work for the Vermont State Highway Department. District 2 Garage was here on Putney Road then, now it's in Dummerston. And Thomas drove truck when I was in high school, and I got to ride with him because we tarred the roads, including Route 30. I remember tarring this road right out here, right through downtown Newfane and Jamaica and everywhere else. We loved working up here because the hot mix plant was in Northfield, Massachusetts, and those trucks, after they dumped the tar here and we spread it out, had to go to Northfield, get another load and come back. So we went up in the woods. We're always told, don't stand out there where somebody can see you. We're high school kids, you know, get up in the woods and get back in the woods. Boys will come get you when we need you. And of course you drove by and said, damn kids, our highway taxes at work. I know what you were thinking. But Thomas went to work just for something to do, driving a truck. He talked to me a lot. And eventually the taxes just became too much for him. And so he kept this plot of land over here. There's now a development here. If you've driven up Black Mountain Road, across the highway, across the highway, just to your left is a new development. But that's where Emerson Thomas built his house. You might remember it up there for a long time. And he would plant his corn every year in that little field on the, in that particular direction, kind of the northwest side of Interstate 91. And he lived there for quite a period of time, but he just could not afford. And after he and his family sold that land to a developer, I was told by Matty Spino, 87 years old, who works at the Auto Mall still, says you gotta have something to do. So he was working there the other day, and he said he believed, and I have not researched this, that most of that land was sold to an entrepreneur new to Brattleboro by the name of John Smythe. And then Smythe sold it off to developers, one of whom might have been Tony Sersosimo, again, not confirmed. And the first thing I remember happening, the topsoil was taken off. Wonderful farmland, but what good is it underneath parking lot? So it was taken away. One of my fellow board members of the Brattleboro Board of Trustees, Brattleboro Historical Society, is Karen Davis. She's paranoid about coming and doing things like this, so finally, after much pressuring by me, she said, no. No, I'm not going to do that. I don't want to be on Facebook, she said. But this is her house being moved off North Street. Exit 2, Western Avenue, the north and southbound lanes going north. That was North Street. And all of those families had their properties either moved or bought outright. And here is a record of it. Down near the bottom, the third one from the bottom, Roger M. and Ann K. Davis, the parents of one of my high school classmates, class of 1968, paid $16,000 by the federal government. Here's the ceremony opening up the interstate. You can see there was much fanfare. This photograph is taken looking north underneath the Western Avenue Bridge. You can see a fairly sizable crowd is gathered. They got a 1915 Model T here. This is the on-ramp for Exit 2. And a brand new Chevy donated for this occasion by Raymond S. Roberts, for whom, ironically, Matt Spino was working at the time. I I'm going to skip some of these in the interest of time. This is the same photo I showed you a moment ago with farmland on Putney Road. Here are some views of Putney Road back in the day. This is in my high school days. That's Putney Road from the east side, which was reasonably well developed then, but it's looking west onto the farmland. I worked for the State Highway Department, I told you, and when we would finish, the Thomases would wait at the garage for the high school kids to come home and ask if we wanted to make some extra money. And they would pay us the same wage, minimum wage, $1.35 an hour, to throw bales of hay until we couldn't see anymore. There were some nights when I went home and it was, I didn't eat some nights. You know, I took a shower, went to bed, back to work again. I wasn't very smart. I'm still not. Anyway, you recognize Brattleboro Bowl on the east side. And there's the Thomas Farm, one of them, down at the corner of Black Mountain and Putney Road. A little different, isn't it? This is the opening of a furniture store, again on the east side of Putney Road, but you can see the west. This is the Brattleboro Reformer Building, just after it was built, on the right-hand side. And you can see how wide open that is then, not anymore. This is Kay's Variety Shop at the corner of Black Mountain and Putney Road. There's King's Bowling Lanes that were built more or less at this time. There's some people, candlepin bowling inside. There's where the Thomas Farm, one of them, was. Now it's Brattleboro Savings and Loan, Radio Shack, etc. Stone Fence Inn. All that's left is the stone fence. It was purchased by the St. John's, who turned it into a home, and then it burned, and they built the new building that's there today. I'm looking at my time up there. I had a couple of other stories I was going to tell you, but my time is very short. I want you to appreciate something that the Brattleboro Historical Society is doing. It put out today, under the directorship of Joe Rivers, a teacher at Brattleboro Area Middle School, its 60-second podcast of Brattleboro history. Every week one comes out. And this one came out a couple of weeks ago. By the way, the Brattleboro Historical Society has become very, very vibrant on the internet. Our website is working and constantly being updated. We posted a picture of a restaurant with an old truck in it a few weeks ago, and 13,000 people looked at it. We have one up there now, and it's almost to 2,000. So there's a lot of visibility. So I'll just play this for you and call it a night. Sorry, you other people. Dorothy Flood, my girlfriend in third grade. Her house got moved to Hinson. Well, never mind. I lost Dorothy. Actually, I think she was ready to say see you later anyway. If she wasn't, she should have been. All right, hang on. Make sure this is on.
This podcast of local Brattleboro history is brought to you by Brattleboro Savings and Loan, the Bank of Brattleboro. It was 60 years ago this week that the residents of Brattleboro saw the first diagram of how the coming of the interstate would impact the town. A gigantic front page illustration of the three exits that would be created with the construction of the interstate was plastered across the front page of the Brattleboro Reformer. In 1956, the federal government decided to build a national network of 41,000 miles of highways across the United States. The federal government would pay for 90% of the cost, and the state governments would pick up the other 10 and would be responsible for the roads and their maintenance in the future. The average cost of interstate construction was $1 million a mile. While many were excited with the idea of connecting the nation together with high-speed road travel, not everyone was happy with the decision to bring the interstate through town. In Windham County, 340 properties were seized by the state government, and approximately 2,000 acres were taken to construct the thruway. In Brattleboro, there were about 100 properties that had some or all the land seized, and there were 23 homes that would need to be moved or demolished. Shirley Wright lived in one of those houses on Northern Avenue. Northern Avenue was a street located between Allerton Avenue and Brattle Street that was demolished and became the second interstate exit in town. 10 years ago, Shirley Wright was interviewed by the Reformer and she said, "The woods and meadows out behind Northern Avenue were beautiful. It was all land owned by the retreat. We used to ski down the retreat pastures. You can still see part of that hill on the northbound land past exit 2. Our living room is now in the middle of the southbound lane." The creation of the Exit 2 overpass has also caused the state to change the path of the Whetstone Brook. The interstate was originally planned to pass through New Hampshire and not Vermont, but Senator George Aiken had more seniority in Washington, D.C. than the New Hampshire delegation, and the path was changed so Vermont would benefit from the highway. In an ironic twist, George Aiken's birthplace in Putney was subsequently paved over by the interstate as the highway headed north. When designing the thruway, states were given the responsibility to hire appraisers who would make offers to the property owners. If the property owners disagreed with the appraisal, they could go before the State Highway Board during compensation hearings and plead their case. Over half, 52 of the 100 Brattleboro landowners, appealed to the State Highway Board for a more favorable appraisal. If the landowners didn't like the outcome of the compensation hearing, then they could take the state to civil court. 33 of the landowners, one-third of the affected folks in Brattleboro, took the state to court asking for more compensation. One of the more unique requests came from Reverend Tegnell, who lived on Chestnut Street, which would be cut in two by the interstate. Reverend Tegnell asked for $2,000 in compensation. Before the construction of the interstate, he could walk 300 feet down the road to visit his friends, but after construction, he would have to walk almost half a mile to get to the same place on a now divided Chestnut Street, and he was hoping to be compensated for the inconvenience. It was 60 years ago this week that Brattleboro saw the first plans for the interstate and began to contemplate the changes. Information for this week's show was gathered from the Brattleboro Historical Society files maintained by Harriet Ives.
Historical Society is interested in upgrading your technology a little bit. These are all 3 or 4 minutes. Just let us know.
Thank you. Great job.
Are you sure?
I thought it was incredible.
I was too fast for this thing. I'm going to come sit next to you now.
But you only use 20 minutes of your 15 minutes, I'm proud of you. We always figure there's going to be a little slip and change. That is the problem. Every one of these talks could probably go an hour and be absolutely fascinating, but there'll be a chance to catch up after the program. We'll take some questions at the end. Next, we are going to have a representative from Putney, Marilyn Loomis, talking about growing up in Putney. So, and I don't know if you want to use the mic.
Not be the blowhard
that I am. I'll use it if I have to. Can you hear me? It's interesting hearing about 91 because we bought some property in Putney in 1960 and 91 went right through it. So we have 40 acres on one side and 60 on the other. And the ones on the 40 acre, we had two houses put up eventually, not ours. But about 10 years ago, I had a piece of land that 91 had taken, and there was no way to get to it. And it was connected to Harlow Sugar House, but there was no access to it. So I didn't want to keep paying taxes on it. So I went to see Don Harlow, asked him if he'd like to buy it, and he said, sure. So I sold it to him for a gallon of maple syrup. It was about a quarter of acre. He was very happy. I was happy and I didn't have to pay taxes. So that was interesting to hear about 91. I wasn't really sure what you wanted to know about Putney, but we have a very active Putney Historical Society. which has done a lot in Putney with various buildings. But I was born in Putney. I went to a one-room schoolhouse, first through fifth grade with one teacher. And at that time, there were three schools in Putney, three grade schools. And we had our own little community. We kind of stayed in our own little community. We had lots of kids in the community. There were maybe four or five families. And so we entertained ourselves. We didn't have all the things they have now. We had a lot of fun in the neighborhood. The teacher, my second year, the teacher got married. And she invited us all to her wedding, which was at the Dummerston Church, and the whole school went. First wedding I'd ever been to. That was kind of fun. And then, right now, Putney has about 2,600 people. Back then, it was about half that. And it was kind of divided. There was East Putney, Putney, Putney Village. And everybody just kind of did their own thing. We have community parties and school parties, and at that time we had the Putney School, which had just started recently, and the Experiment of International Living, which is now SIT, which means the Brattleboro, was started in Putney. Now we have Landmark College, which is a college. We have a private grammar school. We have the Greenwood School, which is for dyslexia children. And we have the regular Central School. And I think there's one more. But Putney is really educational. We have a lot of educational things going on there. I remember when Windham College came to Putney, I was a teenager. And it was terrible. All these foreign kids came from everywhere, and they lived all over town. They didn't have a place until Dr. Hendricks built some property over on the River Road. And I worked at Windham College for 5 years until it closed. And then the place was empty for quite a long time. And then now it's Landmark College, which is very prosperous. And now they have 4 years, so it's a good college. And the kids are all rich kids. We see a lot of Mercedes and things like that around town, but they're good kids. When I was in second grade, we had community parties at the community center, and I'm one of eight kids. At that time, there was six of us, and we all went to the Putney Community Center to a Christmas party. I was 6 years old, and we all got our Christmas. We had Santa Claus and all that, and I went out to the car, and one of my brothers forgot his present. So I said, I'll run back in and get it. So I ran in and got it. Then I came out, and my family had left me. And it was winter, and it was cold, and I had to walk home a mile and a half. And the worst part was, when I got home, they had missed me. They were just like, what are you doing here? And I was like, I got left behind and nobody came. So that was kind of one of my funny experiences growing up. Let's see, I wrote a few other things here. I remember when we had the blackouts, way back in 42, 43, and we had to have all our windows covered certain nights of the week. And I remember going downtown with my dad to a lookout tower watching for planes. I think about it now, it's like, who was going to come over Putney? But that was one of the things that was that I remembered about the very beginning of the war and thinking how scary it was. because we didn't know what was happening. We just had to have everything blacked out. That was kind of interesting. I think Putney has grown a lot over the years. The Historical Society has bought a lot of the buildings and done a lot of things, and it's different than when I was a kid. But we had the Putney Community Center that we went to a couple nights a week. We were able to go down and play basketball and play pool and do things like that. Because none of us had TV. Yes. And we got to know our neighbors, and we visited with people, and people came to your house and visited, and we went and visited. Now everybody's too busy. It's nice to see so many people out tonight, because you could be home watching TV. Or more movies from Bill. I remember we had a lady in town that had a horse and buggy when I was a kid, and she would bring her daughter downtown in a horse and buggy and get groceries at the grocery store once a week. And we all thought that was pretty neat. I think probably most of you remember when you were growing up, you visited more, and you did more things. And I think having community things like this is really, really very interesting. So I guess that's, oh, come to Putney.
We picked up that 5 minutes, and we gained an extra one. Way ahead of schedule. So,
you'll mind the bills.
We're all good talks. We're going to have time for questions at the end, and we'll bring all four folks up here and let you decide what you want to ask them. Larry's going to talk about small town life in Windham County.
Well, actually, thanks. It's a very small part of Windham County. I'm with the Bellows Falls Historical Society, okay. And when I got the phone call, it was a matter of doing a 10-15 minute presentation on a topic of your choice. And I'm trying to think, okay, so I can bring a slideshow on this or a slideshow on that. Oh, no, just something different. So, okay, so how about a riff on about why people are involved in history, why people are interested in history? And I thought, that's like preaching to a choir. You're all here because you're just working. So I jotted down some random thoughts. This will take me maybe a little bit more than 15 minutes, but in having the conversation, I was asked a question. This is the great question, and probably a good number of you will think about it one way, and a bunch will think about it the other way. Are you local? Did you grow up around here, or did you come to the area? And usually when people ask me that question, sometimes I have a little bit of a Yankee bent to me. I'll say, no, my family came up here from the Cape. It's in the 1790s, but still. I had no choice in the matter. I was born here, and were you from Bellows Falls? No, I was from Gageville. Yeah. Some of you know where Gageville is. Did you know it doesn't exist? It's like Brigadoon almost. Gageville is officially North Westminster Incorporated. I don't know if it's incorporated anymore. I think the incorporation was given up. Now, I didn't know that growing up. I just knew I went to the Gageville School, which is now a housing apartment place. And it was four classrooms, eight grades. Growing up in Gageville was very small. It was a lot like being like Opie Taylor on Mayberry, walk to school, uphill both ways, winter and summer. And nostalgia is that things are never were the way they used to be, and they never will be again. So the things about Gageville. Why do people call it Gageville? So this is where things start getting connected. When we talk about Putney, it's one of the older businesses in Putney was Basketville. Basketville is Gage's Basket Factory, which started in Gageville, North Westminster, around the 1840s. The remnants of The dam is gone, the covered bridge that went across where the dam is gone, but part of the turbines and the spillway for that brought the power into the water power into the plant is still there. There's a big mansion there that's still lived in. It was the original Gage mansion from, I think, the 1840s, 1850s. A sad thing the other day was that a house across the street from there burned down. Well, not completely, but it's destroyed. And been occupied for a couple of years. And people were talking about, well, how old that house is. And I said, well, I can tell you this, my great-grandfather lived there. And my father used to tell me that it was a boarding house for the people that worked at the basket factory. Well, over the years, within the Gage family, somebody named Wilson married in to the family. I believe it was Cassius's family who lived right around the corner from there on Forest Road. And eventually that's where Basketville was moved down to Putney, and then I guess to China or somewhere. Pieces to take up on what we're talking about. Interstate 91. Now, from where my house was, which was right on 121, and if you know 121 at all, it was one of those bad corners, so you had at least one or two car accidents every year. My next door neighbors had a picket fence that they put in. Finally, they changed it with well casing that was sunk 4 feet in the ground and filled with concrete. You know them? And I actually have seen cars slam into that. And not know the difference. So it's one of those bad corners. We used to be able to ride our bikes back over through the covered bridge road and go through Allenville. Anybody know where Allenville is? Well, it's right at Gageville. It's just a little bit smaller. It's on back Westminster Road. And it's really cool. Interstate 91 came through. Can't go there anymore, no more road. It cut right across that road. So you can still see remnants of it if you look real quick. The road now starts out from Gageville and comes out at Allen Brothers down by Exit 5. But they used to have a straight cut off across. That was one piece of the connection with Interstate 91. Another piece of Interstate 91, Bill and I went to high school together, not the same high school, but I was also in the class of 68. And when the interstate finally reached the Bellows Falls area, it was stopped for a long time at Exit 6. The bridge going across the Williams River was a very long and extended project, which was intriguing in two ways. First of all, it was a great place if you just had your driver's license and you had an older brother that didn't mind if you borrowed a car some time or had a lot of them. You told this one too. You get on Exit 5, which usually had a barricade across it because they wanted people to come off there, and you could drive like the Dickens back and forth between Exits 5 and 6 and nobody would know. The other part of it is that we lost a bit of history. And one of the things that was kind of famous, and I actually have some nice slides, it was a thing called Barber's Park and the Bellows Falls and Saxon River Street Railway. It actually was a train that went back and forth through there to the mills of Saxon River and also the passenger cars. There was a park that was an entertainment park, which was where they would bring people on Saturdays and Sundays when the mills were closed so they could still make money for the trolley. So it was the trolley company that actually built that park. And for years people wondered, the older generation, the younger generation wondered whatever happened to that park. And we see all these pictures. Well, when they built the interstate, the trolley went out of business in the 1920s, I think it was. Where Barber's Park was the gravel pit that helped build the interstate. Now, I knew it as the Barber's Park gravel pit, but I didn't connect it, believe it or not, with Barber's Park, because that's where everybody went out of sight of the adults to party. So, nostalgia. So, who makes history? One of the things that I'm one of the people in the historical society, I get very involved in the old photographs, the glass negatives, the processed glass negatives, and now working away 160 of those. And I'm now working on celluloid negatives and putting slideshows together and things to those. So that's great, but a lot of them don't have any names on them. Don't have any, you know, some have scenes that we know, but what else? So who makes it? Well, there's a book in Rockingham that was written by a guy who used to be a town clerk and published in 1907, and it's Hayes's History of Rockingham, and then there's a whole bunch of other things that it's a history of as well. And there's a lot of these interesting stories in there, but a lot of things it doesn't cover. I don't know what they are, but there's a lot of things it doesn't cover. I know in genealogy it doesn't cover a lot of names. And then I start thinking, well, okay, so who made the history? Because that's the Bible. You can download it for free on Google Books or Google Archives, the Hayes History of Rockingham, Vermont. Very interesting reason. If you're interested about the giant chicken, giant bird tracks, we can talk about that afterwards. Has some interesting stories about that. But that's what people refer to. That's the Bible. Well, we'll look it up in Hayes. We'll look it up in Hayes. Okay, what if Hayes didn't write about it? Doesn't mean it didn't happen. So where do we look? And that's a secondary source as it is. So what's the primary sources? So there's a lot of that kind of stuff that I get kind of intrigued in. In Gageville, there's a lot of nicknames, place names, things change. There's hardly anything about Gageville in that book, because that was the history of Rockingham. Now, I could walk to Rockingham. It's only a couple hundred yards down the road in Oklahoma. Now, to go to Westminster Center, well, that was like 5-6 miles away. I couldn't ride my bike because you just couldn't get there from Gageville. You had to go down to Bellows Falls, actually, to come across. So that was my community. So this is going to be going on another little bit of a riff. What's a community? What is community? And what's history got to do with a community as opposed to geography? And how do we equate that with the objects that we have? So that's kind of where I'm leading up to. So we have a lot of ephemera. In our historical society, we have some great ephemera. Ephemera is those paper goods, maybe clothing, things like that, that just kind of disappear over time. They can waste away. So we're trying to digitize a lot of the stuff that we have. We have a lot of objects. And people bring objects in. And one of my questions will be, okay, so what's the story behind this? Oh, I found this at a yard sale. Okay. And is it anything related to Bellows Falls area? Well, it's a butter churn. Okay. And I know they made them at Vermont Farm Machine, but is this labeled anywhere? You know, and so we get to that kind of a question. And that's something else that just kind of bothers me a little bit. So preservation of artifacts is one of the big things. And but what is the connection to the artifacts? I agree totally. Having younger folks involved in history is great. But to have an artifact to talk about, I think that's a big thing. To go through a museum, and we have one, and just, here's a bunch of things. Okay, there's just a bunch of things. But what's the story behind them? There are real people that use them. I have a little child's desk on my front porch. I leave recycling stuff on it. And it has LC carved into it. Well, when they were closing the Gageville school, I was in the Army, I think, at the time. My parents were still out in Gageville, and they went there, and they were able to buy some of that stuff. There's more stories I can tell about that. The antique picker story, my uncle was one of the big antique pickers in the area. Uh-huh. When he worked over here at Leland and Gray, some of you may have known. But they bought this table, and the question was, this little desk, whose initials are they? It was either my father's or mine, because his name was Lou. And both of us had a tendency to carry pocket knives wherever we went. Not really sure whose best that is, but it was one of ours, so we still have that. So what I'm getting to is the difference between political boundaries and community. Gageville is part of the town of Westminster. It was an incorporated village. I don't know if it still is. But it was part of the town of Westminster. And I think we all have different communities like that. Westminster West is a community which is part of Westminster, but it's not an incorporated village. So is there a difference? Well, to some people that's a huge difference, good Lord. I try to explain to people that these big differences disappear when you go 500 miles from here and they don't know what state Vermont is in. Gageville and Bellows Falls or Westminster West really kind of fades away in the background really a lot. So part of what I'm looking at for community, so we have these boundaries, political boundaries, we have towns, we have villages, and there is actually, I found a quote of Vermont history book for fourth graders from the 1920s that had a really nice definition about townships being chartered from the state and so forth, and villages created by the towns to provide certain select services to be taxed that were for that area only. And that's exactly why Bellows Falls became a village. It was founded, Bellows Falls Village was incorporated through the town on the grounds, on the site plan, if you will, of the Bellows Falls Fire Company that was providing fire protection for that part of the community back in the 1830s. And it was to generate money for that. Now, believe it or not, that's still an issue. almost 100 years later, that's still an issue. So that's kind of an intriguing thing. I worked for the school system for a number of years as well, and one of the questions people have when they come in, well, I live in Rockingham. But we had to know that because we had people from four different towns come to the school. Well, we look at the address and say, oh no, you live in Westminster. Well, no, I don't. I've got a Bellows Falls address and a Bellows Falls phone number. Well, yes, but I know the house, and you actually live in Westminster. And why? Why would that be a difference? Well, because there's a school community, but then there's the political boundaries. So again, part of that whole thing of the difference of community. Kind of gets back to Interstate 91, so that changed things a little bit. I remember when I was younger, several of the stores in Bellows Falls had signs over the doors. I remember one of them in particular was a little marketplace. Nous parlons français. For the Canadians that were coming down Route 5 to go down to Boston, we speak French. Wow. Okay. You don't see that anymore. In fact, I remember when the principal we had for a very short period of time came in from somewhere else and was kind of upset the way things are going in the school and said, I'm going to change your culture. We had a French teacher that worked with seventh and eighth graders, and she changed the curriculum for the following year, kind of autocratically, to Spanish in order to change our culture. Well, first of all, seventh and eighth graders, it really didn't matter whether it's French or Spanish. It's just the idea of learning a different cultural thing, a little different thing, but no, that's not the culture. If you're looking at that level of culture, there was that French-Canadian tie-in. Data artifacts, oral traditions. One of the things that I kind of wanted to bring to, and it comes to mind, I'm in a variety of different communities, and so are you. And it's not necessarily by boundaries. In my definition, communities have a lot to do with shared stories, the oral tradition, shared experiences, shared histories. Not necessarily the objective histories or the objective boundaries that you can draw on a map. Somebody has to write the book. And right now, not a lot of those books are being written. And if we don't start doing it, I don't know who will. So it's kind of up to us to kind of preserve that. I have an older brother who lives in California. The last time I drove out there, I had stopped and on the way and wrote down different things. And so we're sitting around this barbecue and swapping stories and all that. And I had a couple of things. And he said, you know what? It's all about the story. And I really believe that. It's about the story. It's great to have the artifact. It's almost critical to preserve the artifacts. But the story, I think, is what makes the culture, what makes the community. So the way I started to look at it and was that data, artifacts, those hard items like that, those are objective reflections of history. So I'm going to refer to that kind of a little bit as the history in the head. The oral tradition, the cultures, the things that we talk about and pass along, that people just kind of know growing up. If you've ever been to North Walpole, you know everybody's got a nickname. Now, if you've ever been to North Walpole, you know everybody's got a nickname. Or you know where the, you give directions to the firemen, you say, well, you go where that monument used to be, you know, where the barn burned 25 years ago. Oh, yeah. To me, that's history of the heart. That's a little different. That's the oral. That's the not written down. So that's kind of my traditional thing, and that it's really pretty much all about the stories. That's it. Next time we'll bring next time.
And speaking of stories, what do we do? The old meeting is when you talk about these kind of old stories of Grafton. So, perfect segue.
Thank you for having me here tonight. It's a great pleasure to be able to come and represent Grafton. Although Larry's stories took me back to my boyhood in Bellows Falls. I was born in Brattleboro and then grew up in Bellows Falls through my high school years and moved to Grafton some 50 years ago. But Larry talking about that bridge up by exit 6, I put in three summers of hard labor with a construction company laying that bridge in. That was a pretty fine experience. I was a member of the dynamite crew, so life was a real blast back then. What I did that brought me here tonight is I spent many years working at the inn in Grafton. When I worked there, it was called the Old Tavern, as my shirt indicates, and it is now called the Grafton Inn. When I was hired to work there as a manager, one of my first managerial suggestions was that we change the name of the inn to the Grafton Inn. Because as I worked there for a few months, I would answer the telephone, people would write checks to the inn, on and on. It was always the Grafton Inn. We'd answer the phone, we'd say, the old tavern. They said, yes, I'm trying to get the restaurant. Or, I'd like the hotel. Tavern to people meant a bar. And so that was my first suggestion to the Board of Trustees, and they forwarded immediately. It says, out of the question. And about a month before I retired, 35 years later, it was decided that the name of the inn would be changed to the Grafton Inn. And the consultants that had asked me about that issue were the ones that reaped the financial benefit from it. I felt very, very unfortunate about it. But I had a great career at the inn. I loved my job. And I met fantastic people and had wonderful experiences down the years, right there in the heart of Grafton. I could easily take an hour talking about Grafton history and the history of that inn, which is one of the very few inns in New England that has survived in its original building and on its original site for now well over 200 years. In fact, we celebrated the bicentennial in 2001. I felt very fortunate to be part of that history and was always encouraging the help that worked there, even to this very day, to be mindful of the fact that they're not just doing a job in a hotel, they are in fact curators of history. And I think that's true for any building of any age, but when you're working in one that's over 200 years old, it becomes very much a part of your daily existence. But what I wanted to do tonight was share with you some of the extraordinary experiences I had at the inn, because the heart of an inn is, of course, the guests that come there. And I thought I would tell you just a few stories. In fact, I can see from the clock, maybe I will limit it to two stories that happened down the years to me there. And I might just ask, looking at the general age of the audience, I would like to ask, are there any people here that know a person by the name of Billy Joel? Okay, great. Well, good. You're up to date. I can see that. That's terrific. Well, now, quite a few years ago, I would say probably almost 30 years ago, I took a phone call at the front desk, and it was Billy Joel's manager that was on the phone. And he wanted to book a stay for Billy Joel at the inn for Billy and his wife of that time, named Christie Brinkley, a famous fashion model. His major concern was that Billy Joel wanted a vacation where people would not recognize him, where he could be anonymous and people would not bother him the way they did in the outside world. And he said, Grafton seems to be an isolated place, and I assured him it was. And he said, do you think that if he came under an assumed name, we could be sure that no one would annoy him? And I said, I'm pretty sure that would happen. And he was very doubtful, but he said, we're going to send them there under the names of Mr. and Mrs. Shore. And we got their arrival date, and it was, they were coming up in early December, and that time at the inn, in early December, is a very quiet time of year. We have very few guests at that time, except on the weekends, and they were coming for a week-long stay, coming Sunday night and leaving on the following Friday. So anyway, I was at the front desk when they arrived, and Billy Joel came in first to sort of reconnoiter and figure out what the place was about. Had I not been warned that he was coming, I would have watched him very closely as he walked down by the float rack. Back then, he had a 4-day beard growth, nothing to match mine, but nonetheless, a 4-day beard growth before it was fashionable for that rough, uncut look, you know. And he had on an overcoat with the collar turned up, and he kind of like walked around glowering at everything and kind of like looking out at the sides of his eyes. It was a very unusual posture for a guest walking into the inn. That's not the way guests usually walk. But he walked around for a while, and then he went outside, and then eventually the couple came in. And of course, I had been appraised by the waitresses of what a great beauty Christie Brinkley was. And it was very interesting to see her. She was beautiful, but it wasn't quite what I expected. It was perfectly clear to me why she was a fashion model, because her features were actually very symmetrical, of course, but very plain, very simple lines in her face, and I suddenly thought, she's like a living mannequin. That's why she makes a great fashion model. You could dress her in any way you wanted, and it always looked good, but there were no really strong distinguishing characteristics in her face. Well, at any rate, the Joels settled in, or Mr. and Mrs. Shore settled into their digs, and they had rented the whole house next to the inn. If you know Grafton, there's a beautiful historic home. If you walk out the side door of the inn, you're looking at what is called the Barrett House. It was owned by Captain John Barrett, built by him. And they took the entire Barrett House to guarantee their privacy. But all their meals were going to be taken at the inn. And so they came into dinner that night, and no one bothered them. No one said anything. Everyone addressed them, if they needed to, as Mr. and Mrs. Shore. And back in those days, at the inn, when you came into dinner, breakfast, lunch, whatever, you would basically fill out your own menu. The waitress would present you with a card, she'd announce the specials, and then you would write what it was you wanted, and if she had any questions about it, like how you wanted your steak cooked, you could ask them having read your writing. They undertook this with no problem. They had their dinner, came out, came in the next morning for breakfast, and as the day went on and lapsed into evening, I noticed that rather than relaxing more, Billy Joel seemed to become ever more tense and ever more nervous. Nothing particular happened that day. They, I guess, relaxed, if they were able to do that. They were capable of it. But then the next day, it became even more pronounced. So at breakfast the third day, I could see him in the dining room, and he would be like this during the breakfast, you know, and then he'd sit there and he'd eat something, and then he'd look this way and that way. And I'm like, gosh, what can we do to get him to calm down, you know? It just went on and on. The manager that had booked Paul came in that night and spent a lot of time with the Joels. I could hear him in the dining room talking about what a great place it was. He took them out to the front desk and showed them the names of all the marvelous historic people that had stayed at the inn. And as they were standing here talking about it, I thought, well, Billy Joel's a musician. I said, yes, and you know, recently we had a very great pianist stay with us. And he clearly brightened right up. And I said, yeah, you know, Rudolf Serkin, the great classical pianist, celebrated his 50th wedding anniversary here. And he scowled, and his memory, she said, you know, Rudolf Serkin, the great pianist, he lives down in Guilford, Vermont. And Billy Joel sort of stormed out, came in the next day, and the next night, rather than coming to dinner at the inn, Mr. and Mrs. Joel went up to Ludlow, to where Okemo is located. And they went into several restaurants where they were stormed by people who had them signing menu covers and whatever they could get their hands on. They came back the next day and had breakfast, back to the dining room, had breakfast, and their waitress came up and she picked up the card that Billy Joel had filled out, and she checked it over, brought them their breakfast, and then he was supposed to sign, as all guests did after breakfast, sign the card, and then it was charged to their room. So she presented the card to him to sign it, and she started to walk away. He said, just a minute, and she came back, and he signed in large, clear letters across the bottom of the building, Billy Joel. And she looked at it, and she said, well, thank you, Mr. Shore. And that was the straw that broke the camel's back. He and Christy Brinkley left the inn that morning, went up and rented a condo at Chemo Mountain, where there were, at any given time of the night, 50 people outside with cameras waiting to take their pictures. So it was the only time in the history of the inn where we gave the guests exactly what they asked for, and they were completely dissatisfied. So you have to be careful what you ask for. That was that story. Maybe I can tell you just one more short one. That actually is, I had many incredible things happen to me. at the inn down the years. And this is certainly the most extraordinary. And it's quite a touching story. I don't mean to end the evening on a down note, but it's so unusual that I have to share it with you. And it was about the same time of year that the Joels had called for their reservation with their manager, and I got a call from a young woman. It was late October when I got the call from her, and she went into some explanation on the phone that she was a young hospice worker from up in Hanover, New Hampshire, a part-time student as well. And she said, I'm a caregiver for a young man up here. She said he's in his early 40s and he's very, very sick. And she said, in fact, he's terminally ill. There's nothing the doctors can do for him. And she said, we don't expect he will live more than a couple of months. And she said, as part of our hospice program up here, we try to grant a last wish to people that are in his state. And she said, for reasons that are completely unclear to us and completely unclear to the young man himself, she said, he is obsessed with your inn. She said he's collected newspaper articles, magazine articles, anything he can find about it. He has this great store of things. And he talks about it all the time. He's never been to Grafton, never seen the inn, and there is no clear reason, to our understanding, as to why he wants to come there. She said, but we're hoping, since he doesn't really have any money to his name, that you'll be willing to sponsor it. And I said, well, I'll clear it with the innkeeper. I was not the innkeeper at the inn. I was always the assistant innkeeper, the best job in any inn, I can guarantee you. I got to do the job that everyone thinks an innkeeper should do, whereas the innkeeper himself was upstairs calculating budgets and projections and all this. I got to have all the fun with the guests. It was just great. But at any rate, I cleared it with the innkeeper, a very gracious man. And he said, of course we'd be happy to host them if we have room. Well, at that time of year, we had room all over the place. On any given night, we could have just like 4, 6, 8 guests in the house. So I went and called this woman, whose name was Laurie. I called her up and told her we'd be happy to do this. And she said, well, great. And I said, when would you like to make your reservation? And she said, well, we probably better make it on short notice, but she said, I never know how George is going to be. I mean, he has good days and he has very bad days, and we just don't know. And I said, well, let's just wing it. So let's say next week, what's a good day? And she picked a day. And we did this several times, and each time we approached the day, and George would not be well enough to come. She called me up at one point and said, I've just got to tell you this. She said, I was in class the other day and my beeper went off and I got an emergency call. It was about George. And she said, I went speeding out of class and off to his house. And when I got there, he was in the bathroom and he was on the floor. He'd been sick. He was too weak to get up, but he kept trying to tell me something. And she said, I finally got him up and got him seated, and he kept pointing to the floor. And I looked down, and she said, and there beside the toilet was a Yankee magazine on the floor. And what he was trying to show me was they had a feature article on the inn in the magazine. And she said, it's just the degree of his obsession. And I said, well, great. I said, so we set another date for George to come. We've been through 2 or 3 of these already. And she called me up the morning of the day and said, you know, George is having a good day. We're going to be there. Well, it was a midweek day, Wednesday night, I think it was. Very, very quiet time at the inn, hardly any guests. So it got to be about 2:30, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and George and Laurie arrived. And George came in, and indeed he was gone. He was gone. With a red bandana on his head, he had, of course, lost all his hair. But he was absolutely radiant walking in the door. I mean, he was just beaming from ear to ear. He was so happy to be there. And I showed him around the inn. And we had to support him a little bit. He was in quite a weakened state. And then Laurie said, George, you should go up and take a nap now so you'll be ready for dinner. So up he went to his room. there was an elevator right beside the front desk, and Uppy went to his room, and things went along as normal. It was a very, very quiet afternoon. And as it got on closer to dinner time, suddenly a car pulled up, and a young couple walked in and came up to the front desk, and I presented them with the guest register, and the man signed, and then he stopped for a minute. I was going to take the register away, so wait just a minute. He said, I want to ask you a question. He said, this name right here, he said, George Kurth. He said, has that guy ever been to the inn before? Do you know that guest? And I said, nope, he arrived for the first time this afternoon, never been to Grafton before. He said, you know, he said, all during grade school and all during high school, he said, I had a best friend who was named George Kurth. Mm-hmm. He said, when we graduated from high school, he said, I went off to college and he went off to the Navy. And we fell out of touch with one another, and he said, haven't seen one another since. And at that point, the elevator doors open, and George walks out, and these two guys look at one another. And then they just fell into one another's arms and spent the next several hours, you know, all that evening and all the next day, they spent together. And they were indeed those same friends. And George was gone 6 weeks later. And it was, you know, even for a skeptic like me, when something like that happens to you, you think, wow, there are forces in this world at work for which there is no explanation. I mean, that obsession George had with coming to the end, how that all worked out, just a regular miracle. But I hope that someday I can come back and tell you, I have an awful lot of stories.
That Baskerville got its start in Williams.
Good question. I don't know the answer, but I would suspect that perhaps the same person that was involved in Putney might have thought up for integrating both places.
I think that's what happened.
Okay.
I know that there's a brochure that Baskerville had probably 15 years ago. They actually had t-shirts. I got shows a group picture of all these guys in the mill. They've got do a lunch buckets and stuff. And I know my great-grandfather and two of his brothers are in that picture. So I know there's that one connection to Baskerville, but yeah, I wouldn't be surprised a bit if, as they got bigger and bigger, that they brought in Williamsville too. It would just be logical.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions? Yes?
There's a building in Grafton. I was only there like once a few years ago, but I really liked it. It was across the street from the inn. And it had this really wonderful balcony with a painted ceiling.
Oh, sure.
What's the history of that place? We never managed to figure it out.
Well, that brick house was at one point the Eagle Brook Hotel. Originally, it was built. There were two houses, two brick houses. They're still there. Uh-huh. And they were matched houses. The one beside the one you've described is still in its original state. The other one was altered to create what was called the Eagle Brook Hotel. And the Eagle Brook Hotel, the Eagle Hotel. And the Eagle Hotel was a temperance hotel, which sheltered the righteous. And up the street in the building I worked in were the sinners. But it was originally, the people that built those houses were partners in a woolen business, which was once one of the great industries of Grafton. Before the Civil War, just before the Civil War, there were over 10,000 merino sheep roaming the hills of Grafton. And between the two brick houses, there was a weighing station. so that they could drive their wagon in, weigh their product, take it on down to the stream side, which is one of the two forks of the Saxons River.
Right.
And there was a fulling mill there where they processed woolen cloth. And in their best years, they produced over 75,000 yards of cloth a year in that woolen mill. But that's what that house was.
That's early, that's before the Civil War.
Yes, yeah, that was before the Civil War.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This is a question for Bill. I was wondering if you had any information about some of the other houses that were on the exit one area. I just bring that up. The house that I live in, Sunny Acres, which was from. That was.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. Honestly, I don't know about exit one. I do know that the Page family made an investment in that end of town.
Yeah.
Because of the
ice cream.
Page's ice cream.
Yeah.
But I don't know what homes were moved there. I do know that. One of the more dramatic curves at Interstate 91 goes around the Austin School.
Yes.
That was a political decision. That's what ran the southbound lane through Dorton and Cruz.
I believe that the stagecoach, there used to be stagecoach coming to Manchester. Did that go through Grafton?
Well, I know one of the stage routes that went from Boston to Montreal to Grafton. Yeah.
Because I heard from Charles and Beebe,
yeah.
That I think it was his great grandfather who was driving the stagecoach, and he said that there's the brick house up on top of the hill, that was a stop there, and that's where he met his wife to be.
Probably out through Windham Four Corners. You know, it would have hooked into 121 and kept on going west.
Yeah.
No problem. I'll find the Historical Society in Grafton.
Sometimes I wouldn't be in this. Sometimes I tell people, here's what used to go. Here's where really I get my facts.
Yes. You.
I've been trying to get a poem that Charles Osgood wrote about the blowing up of the bridge in Bellows
Falls.
Yes. Do you does the Historical Society have a copy of that?
I don't know if the Historical Society does, but I do. I don't have that with me. Those of you who don't remember, Charles Osgood was the CBS, Channel 5 CBS, I think. And the Arch Bridge, which was so shaky that you couldn't put cars across anymore. It took him, I think, 3 days to finally take it down. I worked in the middle school at the time, and we had school kids going down. We're going to watch the bridge. And of course, it didn't happen, so we went off on a field trip and went down over there. Actually, the only footage, they had all the, I don't know if it was CNN, but they had all these big satellite dishes, they had all these faces that were there to record this. And they were gone. The only people that got a recording of the bridge going down was the Bellows Falls Union High School Audiovisual Club. They had their own internal TV stations before the public access stuff. They had their own TV stations inside the high school. And they're the only ones that got a recording of it, just kind of laying over and going down. I do have that. If you see me later, I can give you your contact information. I'll scan it, email it to you, if I can find it. I know where it is, though.
Okay.
Good question.
Other questions?
Right here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
It was a one-room schoolhouse for many years, and then it was abandoned, and then an artist moved in, and it was abandoned, and the Shumlin family in Putney bought it, and it's a bed and breakfast now. And it's beautiful. It's right up, it's on the Westminster West Road. And it's beautiful. I had a tour of it not too long ago. No, they had not a bedroom and bathroom because we had a outhouse.
Is that the little brick one right beside the road, is type beside
yes.
the road, just before the trailer goes up to the grammar school?
Yes.
Oh, uh-huh. Okay.
Right. Well, I went there for 5 years. Okay. I'd just like to say that when I came in, I saw the railroad, mm-hmm. and I've been doing some Loomis history, and my father's brother was a conductor on that railroad.
Oh.
I just found that out yesterday. Yeah. So he lived in Springfield, Mass, and he was a conductor. Very interesting pictures.
Other questions? If not, why don't we say thank you? It's been great and a lot of wonderful.